Tomorrow, the road to New Orleans, an NCAA championship preview, and World Cup action from Aspen as the best U.S. ski team ever faces America's downhill tomorrow on CBS Sports.
This is CBS.
Police in Los Angeles are saying tonight they will conduct an autopsy over the weekend to determine the exact cause of Chicago actor John Belushi's death earlier today.
On the economic front tonight, bad news for both the nation and Illinois.
And a report tonight on a new terrorist threat from the mysterious Carlos, next on the 10 o'clock news.
I've never made a practice of telling people how to vote, but when it comes to the office of Lieutenant Governor, I like George Ryan. It's important to me, and it should be important to all of the people of Illinois, the governor and lieutenant governor work together as a strong and effective team. George Ryan is a Republican leader who understands state government. He now serves our people as Speaker of the House of Representatives. Vote for a man who wants to be your lieutenant governor and my partner, George Ryan.
A strong team for Illinois.
Look out, Chicago, here comes Ford.
Come to the auto show at McCormick Place. Visit the Ford display. You could win Bernie the St. Bernard. Here's more value news. Sign up for a free $300 certificate, good on any new Ford. Apply the $300 to your down payment or get a check direct from Ford. See all the 82 Fords at the auto show.
You might even win Bernie.
Here comes you. Here comes now. Here comes Ford.
Cheryl Tiegs, I want to ask you a personal question. Do you color your hair?
Yes, because I trust Clairesse with its unique no ammonia formula.
Clairesse gives you color you can trust. Conditioning you can trust. Gentleness you can trust. And Clairesse is from Clairol, another reason to say,
for beautiful hair, I trust Clairesse.
Channel 2, WBBM-TV, Chicago. Walter Jacobson, Don Craig, Harry Volkman, and Johnny Morris with Chicago's number one news. Channel 2, the 10 o'clock news.
Good evening. Walter has the night off tonight, and Susan Anderson is sitting in. Authorities tonight in Los Angeles are saying that John Belushi apparently died of natural causes. The 33-year-old actor-comedian was found dead this afternoon by personnel of the Hollywood Hotel where he was staying. Some speculate that he may have had a heart attack, but police are still investigating. Bob Surratt has more.
John Belushi's body was found shortly after noon today in bed at his rented Hollywood Hills hotel bungalow. He was in Los Angeles working on a movie at the time of his death. According to the Beverly Hills Fire Department, they were called to the Chateau Marmont, where Belushi was reported unconscious and choking. Concern arose when Belushi didn't answer his phone this morning. Two people went to his room and then tried to resuscitate him. One was hotel employee Bruce Beckler.
We found him and we tried to work on him, you know. But there was no hope because he was just too flimmed up.
His rise to national fame began in 1975 with the beginning of Saturday Night Live.
I got one of these in grade school.
Movie roles followed after he left television in 79. Animal House was one of his most popular films.
Sorry.
Belushi was critically acclaimed for his role as a Sun-Times reporter in Continental Divide. Also set in Chicago, The Blues Brothers, with friend and colleague Dan Aykroyd. Last September in the Channel 2 newsroom, Belushi talked about what he enjoyed doing most, comedy.
I mean, there are a lot of performers who can make people cry and scare them, but there aren't a lot who can make people laugh. I think there are too few of us around, so we should keep doing that.
Well, that's good to hear, because yeah, there is the sort of Woody Allen syndrome to knock what you can do and want to aspire to what you can't do or may not
be. No, I'd rather make people laugh. If I can do it, you might as well do it. We were real lucky to do it on Saturday Night Live, and now they can do it on film.
Police say tonight there does not appear to be any foul play. An unidentified woman who was apparently the last person with Belushi before he became ill was questioned by police. Police questioned her for 4 hours earlier, but she now has been released. Belushi's roots were right here in Chicago. The homecoming king of Wheaton Central High School in 1967, he married his high school sweetheart and started his career in Chicago as a regular member of the Second City Improv Group. He went on to write, act, direct and perform for the National Lampoon, which led to his success on television and widespread fame. But he never forgot his years in Chicago, and neither will we. Don and Susan, his brother Jim, went on stage tonight in the Pirates of Penzance at the Schubert Theater in Chicago.
Thank you, Bob. Second City also went on with the show tonight. Mike Parker has a report.
It was here at the Second City Theater in Chicago's Old Town that John Belushi first learned and then polished his comedy craft. In dozens of different roles during the early 1970s, Belushi learned how to be funny and how to move an audience. Then, in the days of stardom, he would often come back to Second City. A workshop student remembers.
And out of all the people from Saturday Night Live, John was the one that would come back to the Second City and come back to Chicago and remember Dell and remember this place, remember what it was like to be a student. He really cared.
Tonight, a new company of players at Second City and a new audience, but they remember him too.
When I heard it on the radio, it really upset me. It was very sad. He was so young, and he was so talented.
But nonetheless, you're prepared to come here tonight and laugh, yes?
Yeah, I guess that's what he would have wanted. He was a comedian, and his job was to make people laugh.
We're going to bar hop. Come on, hop. Bar to bar to bar.
Yeah. Over to Mother's and over to Byfield's.
Yeah. Yeah, maybe we'll go to the Italian restaurant where you picked up those pants, huh?
And so tonight, the new Second City players went on as if John Belushi had not died suddenly hours before. There was no announcement. As one theater spokesman put it, that's what theater is all about. Mike Parker, Channel 2 News at the Second City Theater on Well Street.
Critic Gene Siskel interviewed John Belushi many times over the years, and now he has some personal thoughts on Belushi's career. Gene?
Well, Don, the professional tragedy of Belushi's death is that he was really trying to turn a corner in his artistic life. As a comedian, no one had a better pipeline to the sense of humor of this nation's young people. Think of Belushi smashing that wimpy kid's guitar in Animal House, and you have to smile. But Belushi told me just a couple of months ago that he wanted to do more than comedy. He took a romantic part in Continental Divide, a darkly comic part in Neighbors. He wanted to stretch as an actor. All that drive for growth is dead now, too. It's always difficult to accept the death of someone so physically exuberant and alive as John Belushi. Last August, he invited me to his home and took me into a soundproof room on the first floor of his Greenwich Village brownstone. That was his favorite room in his house, lined with a wall full of music equipment and another wall full of rock and blues music. He put on some Motown soul music and tried to teach me a dance step known as the Temptations Walk. A dance step he used on Saturday Night Live and in the Blues Brothers movie. He was a fabulous dancer, and he turned the music up real loud, and he danced, and he sweated, and danced some more, and he was very happy. And that's how I'll remember John Belushi, as very much alive. Don, Susan.
I need it bad.
Sunshine and palm trees of Florida. Florida, when you need it bad, we've got it good. When you need it bad, come to Florida.
I need it bad.
As we climb the ladder of personal achievement, struggling for success, striving for perfection, we must not neglect life's little pleasures. The soft spot, where we can relax with beautiful music. Tune to WLAK, my soft spot at FM 94, for music to make life's journey a little easier.
This is the moment. The grain is ripe and ready. This is where Roman meal bread begins. With high protein wheat flour, whole grain hard red spring wheat, whole grain rye, bran, flaxseed meal, and other nutritious ingredients to make every loaf of Roman meal bread light brown, tender textured, and delicious. Roman meal bread, made from the best the land has to offer.
We could do what others do and make our broccoli and cheese sauce with more of the stem. Instead, we use only the best part. And we could make that in our cauliflower and cheese sauce with processed cheese instead of natural aged cheddar. We could take shortcuts on any of our 15 side dishes, but we'd taste the difference. And so would you. Who are we? You've probably guessed. We're Stouffer's.
The country's unemployment rate is on the rise again. According to government figures released today, the unemployment rate for February is 8.8%, and that's the highest it's been since June of 1975. And it means that more than 9.5 million people were out of work last month. Here in Illinois, the unemployment rate jumped from 9 to 9.6% in February, giving Illinois the fourth highest jobless rate in the country. And that means that 542,000 people here are out of work. The CTA says both the morning and evening rush hours went smoothly today, even though a section of the Jackson Park L line remains closed. The city and CTA shut down four stations along that line yesterday after structural defects were found in the 100-year-old Dorchester Bridge. For commuters who usually board the L at one of those closed stations, the CTA had 21 shuttle buses to take them to trains at other stops on the line. The CTA does not know when the bridge will reopen, so those commuters may have to get used to riding the bus for a while.
Poland's martial law regime has sentenced a Roman Catholic priest to 3.5 years in prison for slandering the nation's communist leaders. There's been no comment from the Polish church on the conviction. Meanwhile, the Polish media report that another priest has been arrested in connection with the killing of a policeman. In Paris, it's been disclosed that Carlos, the legendary terrorist, is threatening the French government. David Andelman has details.
Carlos, the notorious Venezuelan terrorist, has reappeared. His latest act, a threat directed at France's Minister of the Interior, Gaston Defferre. Defferre was immediately placed under heavy guard, and security was ordered increased at French government buildings in Paris and French embassies around the world. Carlos, a code name for 32-year-old Ilich Ramirez Sanchez, has masterminded some of the most notorious terrorist incidents in modern history, including the spectacular 1975 abduction in Vienna of the oil ministers of OPEC. In the letter, written in Spanish and delivered to the French embassy in The Hague, Carlos told Defferre that while he respected France's new socialist government, he could not stand by and ignore the arrest of two of his close friends and associates. He warned that if they were not released, there would be serious, though unnamed, consequences. The two in question, one Swiss and one Italian, were arrested February 16th in an underground parking garage in Paris. In their car, French security police found large quantities of explosives. No decision has yet been reached on what to do about the threat from Carlos. The letter was the first real confirmation in more than 7 years that Carlos was even alive, although recently he was reported to be heading a Gaddafi-sponsored assassination team allegedly targeting senior American officials, including President Reagan. The authenticity of the letter was confirmed by the presence of two thumbprints of Carlos. French and American officials have been particularly sensitive to terrorist threats in recent months, since two separate shootings of American diplomats here, one of whom was murdered in front of his Paris apartment. While neither shooting has formally been traced either to Carlos or to Gaddafi, both were believed the work of professional terrorists. David Andelman, CBS News, Paris.
A 29-year-old California man is in custody tonight after attempting to stick up a bank in Davis and then holding three hostages for several hours. The suspect, identified as Eric Roberts of Knights Landing, California, entered the bank after buying a shotgun at a store just two blocks away. Witnesses say the weapon still had the price tag attached when Roberts allegedly fired one shot into the ceiling and ordered everyone to lie on the floor. A silent alarm brought police, and over the next few hours, all but three of the hostages in the bank were released. 7 hours after the incident began, Roberts handed his weapon to one of the hostages, put his hands in his pockets, and walked out of the bank. Harry Volkman's mixed weekend weather outlook after this.
Count all the different ways you can fix chicken, and count on Jewel for great A values. Jewel chicken is fresh, never frozen, so it cooks up tender and juicy. You'll like the price, too. Whole fryers are just 39 cents a pound through Wednesday. And plan ahead for St. Patrick's Day. Put red potatoes on your menu. Through next Wednesday, 98 cents buys a 10-pound bag at Jewel. For basics like red potatoes and grade A chicken. Count on Jewel.
Mr. George Burns.
That's me. GB for the GMO.
the gallant men of old, the nice guys in Chicagoland and northern Indiana with those great Oldsmobiles. They're specialists, you know. I'm a specialist, too. Hit it. When the evening sun's sinking, I've been thinking of my little log cabin home. See? Here's another song. I'll just go for the big finish. The gallant men, the guys with style, specialists who'll make you smile. See, the GMO. You can't get any bigger than that.
There's only one good thing about a Chicago winter. Colby's winter sale.
Sally?
Absolutely everything is on sale at Colby's. Save up to 30% on furnishings from the finest manufacturers, contemporary to traditional, even custom orders. And Colby's design service can help. Save 10 to 30% on everything at Colby's winter sale and make the best of Chicago's winter.
Colby's takes care of you, start to finish.
Sally, you take good care of me.
We're here to say hello. This year we've got it made. We're here to say hello.
Hello.
It's Ice Puppets. We've got the stars. We've got pizzazz. Hello, hello, hello.
See world champion Charlie Tickner and Mr. Debonair Richard Dwyer March 11th through March 21st at the Chicago Stadium. Opening night tickets half price. Call 454-8400.
It's no secret that the auto industry has been going through some tough times lately. It's short on sales and long on debts. But now Ford says it has a new idea, a better idea. It's going to jump into the space age and start using robots on the assembly line right alongside all the humans. Officials say they'll open their first robot factory later this year in Dearborn, Michigan. Maybe we'll see robots up here someday.
I don't know. I don't know if robots could do anything about our weather tonight. I think we're going to start seeing a little bit more sun, but also a little more cold.
It'll be warmer tomorrow, but colder Sunday, Don. And Susan, we have a weekend that's going to see a lot of sun. The storm in the south has produced a good deal of snow and ice in Texas, New Mexico. Colorado's finally cleared out after they had a storm. It's moving into Arkansas and the Ozarks, up to about Columbia, Missouri, and Stevens College tonight as the snow moves eastward, changing into rain. Typical spring-like thunderstorms hit hail around Dallas, Fort Worth today, Louisiana, and in Florida. Jupiter and the Palm Beach area had 2 to 3 inch cloudbursts. But it's still winter up through the north with temperature only 17. These are today's highs. Another map coming up soon will show you tomorrow's highs. As the high pressure now near Omaha moves eastward, it will be bringing in the southwest to west winds and warmer. Then the cold front comes in Sunday. Only a few flurries may occur around the lakes region, mostly in Michigan and Indiana, for mostly Saturday night and Sunday. This view from the satellite, the infrared shot, shows the dark rain cloud areas down in Alabama. And that's the black region. And then as we get up into this area, there are very few clouds producing any precipitation for our state of Illinois. These are rain clouds and snow mixed down in through that area of the south. Tomorrow morning at 8 o'clock, we'll see a chart that will have high pressure sticking its nose in from the west, pushing in some milder air. But then those dragon teeth, like the Siegfried line, will bring the colder air in from the north on the weekend. Then northeast winds keeping it chilly and damp. A fella called me going to North Carolina to golf. He'll be soaked all weekend. Florida will get a few showers, but still be warm. Notice that 88 that they had in Fort Myers. Here's the snow area for tomorrow morning. It's shrinking down to a small region. We'll be in the sunshine, so you can plan to watch the snow melt. Looking out the window, you can go out and enjoy it and help it with a shovel, maybe, or salt. The temperatures tomorrow should be in the 30s here, and then that 20 zone will swing down with the north winds on Sunday. Here are some of the local conditions reported in here tonight around 10 o'clock. Our old friend Joe Bisek, we used to talk to about 4 years ago, reported a 10-degree temperature up here in the Chain of Lakes area. Glen Ellen, 17, Joliet, 20, and down the east side region, 25. Tomorrow's winds, southwest 10 to 20. The season snow, 46 and a half, now well above normal. It's now the snowiest March in 10 years, and it's only five days gone. We had 12.1 inches already this March, and the biggest amount was actually 22.5 inches in 1965, if you're keeping records. Here are the readings now at 10 o'clock tonight around Chicago. O'Hare, 10. Lakefront, 25. That's a 20-degree drop at O'Hare since 5 o'clock this afternoon. Midway, 19. The records are 68 in 1921, and 4 years ago tonight it was zero in Chicago. And the high today, 34, the low 9, humidity 80%, there's no wind out there, barometer 30-22, and it's a little unsteady. Sun is up at 6:18 and sunsets 5:47 Saturday afternoon. For tonight then, fair and cold, low 5 degrees inland to 20 near the lake. Tomorrow, Saturday, should be a 35 high with southwest winds 10 to 20. I meant to change that too. And then early in the morning, sunny, it'll be down to 12 with a day that'll warm up only to about 20. But it'll warm up after that as we go to Monday, warmer 34, Tuesday 42, and then Wednesday, some rain showers and 36. No snow in that forecast. Back to Don and Susan.
And if you keep the snow away, I won't complain. Thank you, Harry. Tonight, we have the second part of a response by the tobacco industry to the coverage it receives from the news media, coverage that it feels is often unfair. Tonight, a response to charges which claim that the industry is aiming its advertising at children.
There is a confidential report on cigarette advertising in the files of the federal government right now, a viceroy advertising, the viceroy strategy for attracting young people, starters they are called, to smoking. For the young smoker, a cigarette falls into the same category with wine, beer, shaving, or wearing a bra. An attempt should be made, says the Viceroy Slicksters, to relate the cigarette to pot, wine, beer, sex. Do not communicate health or health-related points.
Recently in Washington, we interviewed the Tobacco Institute's chief spokesman. He flatly denies the charge.
Advertising has never made smoker of a non-smoker. It encourages people who already smoke to switch brand loyalty or to maintain their brand loyalty.
Several months ago, an anti-smoking advertising campaign featuring Brooke Shields was scrapped by the U.S. Congress. It was reported then that the cigarette industry's clout was responsible.
Well, I have no reason to suspect that the people at the Department of Health and Human Services were wrong when they said they thought it wouldn't be a good campaign, that she was an inappropriate model.
Did you argue the case against that poster, or anybody in this organization
argue against
the use of
that
poster?
We didn't even know about it.
How much of your clout is tied, would you guess, as a professional in Washington, to campaign contributions?
Well, obviously, campaign contributions play a role in access to a politician. And it shouldn't surprise anyone to see senators from the Carolinas, Virginia, Tennessee, and Kentucky standing up for tobacco. That's their bread and butter. That's how the people they represent make a living. Without tobacco, you'd have perhaps 250,000 farm families out on the street, literally, with no place to go, nothing to do except collect welfare.
Merriman says the news media should take another look at the way it handles the stories that deal with smoking. That because of the impact those stories have on the public and the tobacco industry. Susan?
A big surprise for DePaul. John Drummond has that story when we come back.
Get up to $2,000 from Lincoln Mercury. Get a $2,000 introductory cash bonus on Continentals, $750 on Caprice, $750 on Cougar, $750 on Zephyr. And here's another offer on Lynx and LN7 you save coming and going. A 5% cash bonus off the base sticker price, plus a 2-year free warranty and 2 years free scheduled maintenance. See your Lincoln Mercury dealer for a program with the broadest range and variety in the business. America's coming to the cats for affordable value.
This is Larry Lujak. Animal Stories is more than just a feature on my morning WLS radio program. It's a serious responsibility, one that requires research, determination, and courage. My beat is the animal kingdom, my job to give you its news firsthand.
I wouldn't have it any other way. Right, little Tommy?
Right, Uncle Lair.
Good morning, chillins. It's time for Animal Stories.
Mornings with Larry Lujak on WLS.
Right now at Ward, save 20% on all furniture in stock. Save 20% on every dining room group and every living room group. Save 20% on all rockers, recliners, and accent chairs, even Lazy Boys. Sofas and sofa sleepers are all 20% off, every one. Matching tables and wall units are 20% off. Save 20% on all dinettes. Complete bedroom sets, all mattresses, and box springs are 20% off. Save 20% on every piece of furniture in Ward stock, now through Saturday.
So bad news tonight for DePaul fans. Here's John Drummond.
Well, Don, it was billed only as an exhibition game, does not count in the final standings, but a group of former college stars known as the Athletes in Action tonight defeated DePaul. The final score was the Athletes in Action 91 and the DePaul Blue Demons 86. The Athletes, wearing the red uniforms, dominated the early going. That's Dave Johnson scoring here on a jumper. Johnson was high for the Athletes with 27 points. Then Dan Frost, who played collegiately at the University of Iowa, commits larceny, takes it all the way down the court for the dunk. But DePaul fought back, and as usual, Terry Cummings was a factor. Cummings had 27 points tonight. Here he takes a pass and scores from underneath. Another Blue Demon basket coming up. Skip Diller does the honors with a jump shot. A full house, though, watching DePaul lose at Alumni Hall on the north side of Chicago. Let's look now at some of these other college scores tonight. Top-ranked North Carolina and North Carolina State both posted victories in the Atlantic Coast Conference tournament at Raleigh, North Carolina. In the two other Atlantic Coast Conference quarterfinal games, Virginia just a winner, squeaker with Clemson. Wake Forest too strong for the Duke Blue Devils. Now, in the Mid-America Conference tournament, Northern Illinois beating Bowling Green by just 1 point, and the Big Eight Conference tournament, highly regarded Missouri a winner over the Nebraska Cornhuskers. Turning now to professional basketball, the New Jersey Nets reeled off their fifth straight win tonight at the expense of our Chicago Bulls. The Nets down the Bulls by a score of 107-90 at the stadium. Roy Ray Williams, who played at Minnesota, steals the ball and goes all the way here for the basket. Williams paced New Jersey tonight. He had 20 points. The Bulls look like they're up to the test, though. Theus to Sobers to Dwight Jones, who scores two of his 14 points. But then the Nets scored 14 unanswered points. Watch Buck Williams take a nice pass to get his bucket. Darwin Cook came off the bench to garner 17 points for the visitors as 10,000 fans at the stadium see the Bulls lose their second straight game. Now turning to the high school scene today, these are tournament games. In the public league tournament, a big surprise, Vocational too strong for King, winning by just 2 points. De La Salle over Oak Park by 10 in another regional game. St. Joseph's from suburban Westchester beat Lyons Township 59-43. And down in balmy Mesa, Arizona, the Cubs are hard at work. And our Johnny Morris reports they are trying to build a new tradition.
We knew when we took the job that the thing we had to do was change the thinking and approach the work of the Chicago Cubs, and we had to start something new and something fresh, and to do that we needed a slogan. The slogan's building a new tradition. I think it fits beautifully because the old tradition was passed on by the Wrigley family to the Tribune Company, and the Tribune Company's very anxious to build a new tradition for the Chicago Cubs.
So the byword is a new Cub tradition, hard work and some new faces, which will hopefully make the Cubs a contender. New manager Lee Elia knows his pitching is suspect, but prays for some winners out of no less than 24 pitchers in camp. Is Elia the stern taskmaster we've heard about?
Well, I don't think I'm what you'd call a real strict disciplinarian. That's not my nature. Mm-hmm. In the same respect, I have a program that I think can work. I know it worked before. Mm-hmm. And as long as they work it and stay within the guidelines of my approach, I don't think we'll have any problem.
Fun?
Give me five. Give it to me. All right, give it back.
And games. That's the story here in Mesa, Arizona. This is Johnny Morris for Channel 2 Sports.
And another baseball story. The Milwaukee Brewers have traded outfielder Thad Bosley to the Seattle Mariners. The Mariners sent to Milwaukee pitcher Dave Mike Parrott. You may recall that Thad Bosley formerly played for the White Sox. Showdown time tomorrow in the Big Ten. Golden Gophers of Minnesota can clinch the title outright if they beat Ohio State. If Minnesota loses, there's a possibility of a three-way tie for the championship.
Too bad about DePaul tonight.
It may be a blessing in disguise. It may be with the tournament. Maybe that's what they needed, a tonic now to bring them back to earth.
Okay, that's our news for tonight. Thank you for joining us. Have a nice weekend. Good night.
Good night.
Dominic's has lettuce on sale. Crisp, large-sized head lettuce makes a great salad and is economical at just 38 cents a head through Wednesday at Dominic's.
Before you buy your next car, think Cadillac first. $750 cash bonus on Cimarron, $2,000 on Seville. See your Chicagoland Cadillac dealer tomorrow.
John M. Smith is closing their Michigan Avenue store, and everything is reduced an unprecedented 25 to 60%. Sale starts at 11 a.m. Friday. Come early. Al Narkin, Orson Welles, and Martin Balsam star in the comedy drama Catch-22 tomorrow night at 10:30.
Something you like so much. You talk about your cats. I'm talking about Fred Winston. Crazy Fred. Funny Winston. Outrageous mornings on AM 1000 WCFL. It's a good time. WCFL. Music. Fun. Good sports. News. Fun. Topped with a nut. Fred Winston. For music, news, and weather, this is it. AM 1000 WCFL.
Delicious coffee.
It's New Manor House Light.
Light?
Light. They reduced the caffeine by a third.
But retained the rich taste.
Light.
Now I can have that second cup.
Light.
Now I can enjoy rich coffee after a late dinner.
Light.
They didn't decaffeinate all of it. They reduced the caffeine by a third.
Light. It's a new kind of coffee.
Very new.
And very kind.
McLaughlin's Manor House Light. Light. Coffee.
We've reduced the caffeine and retained the rich taste.
Catch 22, Saturday night at 10:30.
Tonight, on the CBS Late Movie, medical science explores the unknown and discovers that the cure can be much worse than the disease. As one of the most feared words in the world becomes a frightening reality, the word is plague. It began as an experiment that would benefit all of mankind.
The bacteria works, Bill.
But something went terribly wrong.
We've got to find out how this thing got out of the lab.
It's not the flu, darling!
It looks like this thing is highly communicable.
Fear takes over.
She's a carrier.
And the hunt is on in a world gone mad with terror. Escape is impossible. A network television premiere. Plague.
Bill in yet? No. Ask him to come up to my office when he gets here, will you please?
What's the matter with them anyway?
They're afraid. This kind of research is enough to burn anybody's little fingers.
The lab's totally sealed off now. It's foolproof.
Foolproof? Nothing's foolproof. And there's always a fool around to prove it. Talk to you tomorrow.
Right. Can I bring it down?
They'll never know what we're doing.
The lab hasn't even been checked out yet.
Well, we'll do everything in the high containment area. People are violating the standards all the time in Europe. They'll end up with a Nobel Prize, and we'll end up with nothing.
Will you please take it easy? Tuesday night, I have a chance to convince the trustees. We'll get the money, don't worry. And you'll get your Nobel Prize. Don't worry. It's just epilepsy.